Čovjekova psiha još uvijek je nemapirano, teško dokučivo i ponekad neprohodno područje. Malo toga egzaktnoga se može reći o psihi. S takvim izazovom, koji u punom sjaju predstavlja kompleksnost čovjeka, odavno se suočila psihoterapija. S namjerom pomaganja ljudima s mentalnim poremećajima razvijen je raspon načina, od razgovornih seansi s psihijatrima, grupnih terapija i medikamenata. Ovi potonji često se izlažu kritikama zbog rizika stvaranja ovisnosti i umrtvljivanja ljudskog duha. No, bez prave alternative ponekad su neizbježni. A prava alternativa mogla bi biti daleko sveobuhvatnija nego što se čini, poljuljati same temelje psihijatrijske prakse, te početi već s imenovanjem poremećaja u raznim psihijatrijskim priručnicima koji svake godine postaju sve deblji. Američki psihoterapeut Daniel Makler nakon iskustva 10-godišnje prakse došao je do drugačijih pogleda na psihijatriju, o čemu je napisao 3 knjige i napravio 3 dokumentarna filma. Čime se u njima bavio i kako je do toga došao, saznat ćemo ovdje, na rubu znanosti. Dobro večer. Daniel Makler, američki redatelj dokumentarnih filmova o temama iz područja mentalnog zdravlja, u New Yorku je vodio licenciranu praksu psihoterapeuta više od 10 godina, a u okviru projekta Psihičko zdravlje u zajednici, terapija po mjeri čovjeka, pod uprtog i od strane našeg ministarstva zdravlja, udruga Ludruga iz Zagreba pozvala je Maklera da gostuje u Hrvatskoj. Na turneji je posjetio 6 hrvatskih gradova, pa tako usput i naš studio. Dobro večer.
Hello.
Ispričajte nam ponešto o vašoj karijeri, kako ste od psihoterapije, odnosno od posla psihoterapeuta, došli do snimanja filmova o psihoterapiji?
Well, I first became a psychotherapist when I was 27. And it really came out of a passion to be useful to people, to connect with people in a way that had allowed some of my gifts to be able to be helpful to individual people. And I did it for 10.5 years, but throughout the process of that career, I started realizing that I had messages that I wanted to share with more people than just 30 or 40 people a week. And I realized that some of these things that I wanted to say were best expressed through film. I did a lot of writing, but I realized a lot of people weren't reading the stuff that I was writing, even books that were published by reputable publishers. And so film became something new for me to explore. And it was especially exciting because I'd never actually studied film. I'd studied psychotherapy. Mm-hmm. I'd studied a lot of psychology. I'd studied a lot of other things, but I'd never studied film. So it was really new. It was kind of scary. Mm-hmm. And for me, it was a challenge. And I realized I was the kind of person that really got excited mm-hmm. with challenges. So film, for me, was something that gave me a much broader audience. Though when I started, I had no idea if anyone would watch anything that I did. But mm-hmm. eventually they did. Mm-hmm. And it basically introduced me to a world audience over time.
Do kakvih vas je stavova i zaključaka dovela vaša 10-godišnja praksa kao psihoterapeuta? Naime, danas se nekako i sve češće pomalo mogu čuti u vidu raznih tekstova po novinama i slično, nekakva razmišljanja o tome koliko su zapravo dijagnoze psihijatrijske utemeljene, vrlo često su opisne, pune su kratica kojih je svake godine sve više. Evo, mislim da je prije koju godinu izišlo i novo izdanje 5. tog dijagnostičko-statističkog priručnika za mentalne poremećaje, DSM, moje kratica, na kojoj su mnogi opet imali prigovore da je to opet upliv izmišljanja bolesti, ne znam, upliv farmaceutske industrije i slično. Kako je vaše ovako mišljenje kao čovjeka koji se time bavio o tome koja su ograničenja i mogućnosti psihoterapije, veze sa lijekovima i gdje bi trebale biti te granice?
Good questions. Where to start? Well, first, what did I learn as a psychotherapist? I learned that what people really needed and what I really had to offer was a human connection. And that started with really listening to people. And I was trained in diagnosing people. I actually had to diagnose everyone that came into my office. It was part of the law as a New York State licensed clinical social worker. I diagnosed everyone according to the DSM, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual. And what I realized, though, is those diagnoses were virtually useless. Not even virtually useless. I just found them useless. They didn't tell me anything about how to really work with people and how to help people. And I met a lot of therapists who really believed in them, certainly a lot of psychiatrists who believed in these diagnoses, obsessive compulsive disorder and schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, major depression, dysthymia. And for me, what I found is I could meet someone who was given some label, some diagnostic label, but it told me nothing about how I was supposed to help them. And often what I found is people that had totally different diagnoses maybe needed one thing, and people who had the same diagnoses needed something totally different. So I just found that basically diagnosis for me became a way that I just had to, it was like bureaucracy. Mm-hmm. I had to do it for my job. But at first I found it kind of a neutral thing, just something I had to do mm-hmm. to do my job. But as time went on, it became something that was much more negative because mm-hmm. when I really listened to people, I realized that the people who did well in therapy, even some people who didn't do well in therapy, found these diagnostic labels very hurtful. They didn't find them helpful themselves. Some people found some comfort in saying, oh, this is my problem. I've got this thing. But I've got this thing called schizophrenia. I've got this thing called obsessive compulsive mm-hmm. disorder. I've got this thing called ADHD. But just because they had this label didn't give them any tools to actually work on their problem. And it didn't give me any tools as a therapist. For me, I had to listen to other things quite beyond some little book that said, this is what their problem is. I had to listen to my heart. I had to listen to my intuition. And that was something that they couldn't teach in school. That's something that they can't teach out of a book. And at first, when I became a therapist, it was very confusing to me because I was like, what really does help people? And how do I gauge that people are getting something out of what I'm doing? I mean, I actually did have my university degree for 4 years in biology, and I did have a solid grounding in the scientific method. And when I became a therapist, I tried to apply that scientific method, and I had no clue how to do it because I thought often, like, how do I assess this? And I realized it you could apply the scientific method, but in a different way. And one of the basic things that I would do is I would ask people, is this helping you? What do you want? What do you need? What do you feel like you need? And what I learned over and over again is that people very easily, no matter what their diagnosis is, no matter how many problems they had, no matter how supposedly crazy they were, they could express themselves and express themselves very well. And what I found is people who were supposed to be out of touch with reality, people who were supposed to be psychotic or schizophrenic, could express themselves in very, very fluent ways. And I realized by listening to them that what they said made a lot of sense. And when I started reading their charts, many of them had seen lots of therapists over the years, lots of psychiatrists, lots of hospitalizations. Many had been given tons of different diagnoses, and they'd been given diagnoses that were different depending on which doctor they saw. But what I realized by reading their charts and listening to what they said about their past therapists is I got very little out of reading what people had written about them, but I got a lot out of what people said. Like, I heard mm-hmm. things, like, frequently, because I worked with a lot of people who were considered, like, serious cases, and in part because I was a young therapist when I started, and people didn't want to give me more high-functioning people. A lot of times, therapists didn't trust me so much, and also I was very outspoken. I was actually very critical of a lot of my colleagues. So they said, oh, we're not going to give him good clients. We're going to give him the ones that nobody wants. So especially when I worked in clinics, I would get the people who were diagnosed with schizophrenia, who were taking a lot of medication, who had lots of hospitalizations, people who were considered kind of impossible, the kind of people that were difficult to sit with. They had so many problems that they weren't supposed to be able to be helped. So they said, well, we can give him to Daniel or give this woman to Daniel to work with because we really don't care what happens to this client. And I realized I was getting a lot of the disenfranchised people. And when I listened to them, I realized what a lot of what they said made sense. They said things like, I don't like being put in a hospital. I don't like being pressured to take psychiatric drugs. I want to come off my drugs. I want to take fewer drugs. Why is it that psychiatrists and my last therapists, they didn't really ever want to help me get off my drugs? How come they didn't want to listen to me? How come whenever I started getting more stressed out and having more problems, they would just put me in the hospital? And when I listened more to people, and especially when I developed a bond with them, when the people would start to trust me, I realized that that trusting relationship, and that goes for people with the most serious problems and the most serious diagnoses, down to people who didn't seem to have too many problems at all, when people were able to develop a trusting relationship with me, and I think with any therapist, then they didn't need medication as much. They didn't need to go to the hospital. They had some bond in the outside world that could anchor them, and they felt connected to another person. So they could use me sort of like a close family member that they trusted. And I realized that I had to give a lot of myself. And I was criticized by other therapists for this frequently. I was criticized by supervisors because for about 5-6 years I had to do supervision formally to get my level of licensure. And my supervisors often told me, you know, you're taking your problems home after work. You're bringing them home with you. I would tell them, I'm dreaming about my clients sometimes. I'd wake up in the morning thinking about them. I'd wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning sometimes thinking about something that someone had said during the day. And at first, I was a little bit more naive. I told my supervisors what I was really going through. And they were critical. They were like, you shouldn't be bringing this home. You have to learn how to, when the day is done, when your work day is done, you have to go on your life. You have to keep a separation between your work, your clients' lives, and your lives. You have bad boundaries. And that made me insecure. A lot of my training actually made me really insecure. It didn't help me as a therapist. But as time went on, I realized, no, actually, what I was doing was quite right. I was giving my heart, I was opening up, and I was really developing human equal bonds with people, whereas I wasn't some special person telling them what to do, but instead I was someone who could really listen to them and join with them in whatever they were going through. Mm-hmm. And I realized all these other therapists and supervisors and clinicians who were criticizing me were exactly the type of therapist I would never want to send a client to, because they weren't really developing bonds with people. And it's a little cliche. People say, oh, people, you know, what really cures is love. Really loving someone helps. And it's cliche, but at the same time, it's true.
Mm. Na taj način je postalo kliše, što je točno. Tako obično nastaju klišeji.
Da. Spominjali
ste vašu studiju biologije. U kojoj mjeri se može povezati biološki aspekt čovjeka sa svim ovim stanjima koja u sve debljim i debljim knjigama opisuju ovi priručnici DSM i drugi. S obzirom da često puta neke od ovih poremećaja opisuju sa recimo 10 stavki i onda čovjek zapravo, terapeut, promatra koliko tih stavki može uočiti kod pacijenta i nekako tu važe koju bi mu dao etiketu, zbog toga se one toliko i razlikuju. Znači, reč je o jednoj osobnoj procjeni. U kojoj mjeri možemo povezati biologiju sa tim poremećajima? Naravno, to ima veze zbog toga jer lijekovi naravno imaju veze sa djelovanjem na biologiju čovjeka, prije svega. Pa iz toga možemo vidjeti u kojoj mjeri lijekovi mogu pomagati ili ne mogu. Kakva su uopće vaša iskustva? Već ste spomenuli da su ljudi po vama uzimali previše lijekova, ali postoje li neki lijekovi koji jesu korisni, koji pomažu ponekad? Neki ljudi kažu da ponekad čovjeka treba dovesti u nekakvo stanje ravnoteže da bi počeo se razvijati u dobrom smjeru. Ja ne znam koliko je to točno ili nije, ali kakva su vaše iskustva vezano s tu biološku vezu, lijekove i osnove, temelje tih takozvanih poremećaja?
So I could go with that first in a lot of different ways. First of all, what was my study of biology like, and how did my study of biology in university connect with my work as a therapist and connect with the DSM? I would say what happened to me in biology, I'll start with that just briefly. When I was 18 to 22 years old and studying biology, but I was also very interested in what was going on emotionally inside of me. And whenever I tried to talk about this in my biology class, people said, no, that belongs in psychology. You really shouldn't be talking about biology. You shouldn't be talking about an animal's feelings and people's feelings and intuition. This really is not scientific. You need to go more into the social sciences of psychology. And I was disappointed because I felt biology was the study of life. I had a passion for biology. I didn't have just a distanced scientific interest in it. And I loved reading field guides where you would read the books that would describe the birds and all the different things in their life and their behavior and how long their beak was, or learning about all the different reptiles of the world. I loved doing that. But when I went over to the psychology field, especially when I became a therapist, there was a lot of talk about biological psychiatry. And I realized that when they got especially into the more severe diagnoses like schizophrenia, things like that, bipolar, those were called biological illnesses, biological mental illnesses. And I realized when I was trying to do therapy with people, many therapists said, you can't even work with those people therapeutically to really help them get to the bottom of their problems, help them work it out and move on with their lives and leave these diagnoses behind. So basically what I realized is when I started talking about really deep problems, the deepest, most painful traumas, in many ways that wasn't even considered psychological. That was considered biological. So they wanted to send me back to biology. So I realized it was a big loop of like trying to avoid the problem. Biology didn't want to deal with it. They called it psychological. And psychology didn't want to deal with it. They called it biological. And then I was like, ah, I get it. It's a game. It wasn't real. I was like, so over time, and this is what's happened to me. This has been a big part of my development. I would say as my career, but as a person, is to realize I'm not going to listen to so much of what they say. I'm going to listen to what I feel, and most especially what the people across from me were saying. And so I'm going to get to your question about medication in a second. But so where does biology fit into this? At one level, everything is biology. Every thought we have has some biological correlate. Every feeling we have, love is biological. Sex is biological. Thoughts are somehow biological. But because biology is life. But I think what is biological, when they talk about it in psychiatry, what is biological, I think they mean something is wrong with a person's brain. And I don't personally believe that. I mean, yeah, people's brains can be a little weird. My brain's a little weird sometimes. But what really is biology? I really don't know when it comes to psychology, when people have really deep problems. But instead, what I heard, when I really talk to people and listen to their stories, and this is pretty much everybody that I talk to, no matter how serious their problems were or how mild their problems seemed, is that people had painful childhoods. People had real conflicts that went way back in their lives, way very deep into their personalities.
Da, zapravo je biologija jedna veza s obzirom da se neke od tih iskustava na neki način odražavaju na načinu kako se mozak slaže kroz izražavanje gena i kroz neuroplastiku, pa tu možemo naći biološki temelj. Ali od kuda se stvorio taj biološki temelj, to nas opet vraća na sasvim drugo područje. Nije se stvorio samo od sebe.
Right, I think I understand what you're saying. But I still say, for me, I don't think the foundation ultimately is biology, as they refer to it in psychiatry. I think the real foundation, in my experience of what people's real deepest inner conflicts is, comes from trauma. And it's just a very different perspective. I guess you could say everything is biological, again, but things do express themselves in people's biology. And yeah, people's brains are affected. But part of what I've also gathered, having studied biology and talking to a lot of neurobiologists and things like this, is the brain is so complicated, half the time we can't even figure out what's going on. Half the psychiatric drugs they're giving to people, they don't really even know what they're doing to people's brains. A lot of it seems to be trial and error. Hey, let's try this drug and see what happens. One person that gives a side effect where their hands shake, another person their kidneys shut down, another person gets diabetes, another person has no side effects, all on the same medication. So for me, perhaps in a way for the sake of simplicity, but also what I found useful, and also what I've heard from people, is so many people at least, is that when people are able to tell their stories and not look at themselves so much as biological beings with problems in their brain, but people with problems in their relationships, people with problems in their history, people who are having conflicts with their thoughts and their desires, wishes, their dreams, their fears, that for me, exploring those kind of things in relationship to people, whether I'm a therapist or not, and or also just in my relationship with myself, was much more useful than studying biology in terms of helping people. And what I came to over time was, in a way, this is my version of biology. And exploring people and really understanding people better and understanding their conflicts and creating a sort of a three-dimensional map of how people are and my understanding of humanity, that's my attempt to create a real field guide about people. And I think the DSM, how I look at the DSM, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, the Bible of psychiatry, I look at it as a pseudo field guide. It's a field guide, it's an attempt to try to create a field guide to understand people's problems. But when it's compared to a real field guide, let's say of mammals or of birds or of trees, it's so simplistic and incorrect that I prefer not to use it at all. Now, when it comes to medication, because medication does treat people's brains, it treats things in their bodies also, in general, I'm quite against it. I think I have a lot of reasons for not liking the medication. The most obvious one is just so many people have terrible side effects on psychiatric medication. One obvious one being many people just feel very low energy, feel like zombies, especially when they're given many medications. But another main one is that part of what I see with medications a lot is it takes people's feelings down. So their feelings are less intense. They have sort of a tranquilizing effect on a lot of people. And what I've experienced is that for people to really heal, for really to work through whatever their problems are, they need their feelings. Their feelings are sort of their roadmap. They're a flashlight to get through whatever it is. And without people's feelings, often they're calmer. They can feel more relaxed. They can sleep better. And sometimes sleeping better can be very useful with medication. That's one of the best things for the medications often, is so people can get a good night's sleep and wake up in the morning feeling a bit more rested. But people need that passion. And I don't see medication giving people their passion. I see medication taking people's passion down. Now, I sometimes actually take psychiatric drugs. When I flew over here from America, when I flew to Croatia, I was flying overnight. And I'm like, I'm a big, tall guy. I'm not going to sleep very well in the airplane. I was in economy class where I was touching the seat in front of me. I took a Valium. I get it prescribed. I take it probably 7 or 8 a year just for overnight flights. And that's a psychiatric drug that a lot of people take. I've talked to people in Croatia who take it. And I find that many people who do end up in the hospital, it is precipitated by not sleeping well. So people who get diagnosed with schizophrenia, sometimes they haven't slept for 5 or 6 or 7 days. And anyone will go a little bit crazy if they don't sleep for 5 or 6 or 7 days. The brain just isn't working right. People get loopy. So anything that's going to help them get to sleep, especially get to sleep fairly quickly, would be very useful. So sometimes drugs like Valium, benzodiazepines, just given for a few days, is sometimes enough to help people come right out of psychosis without ever even having to go to the hospital. But when it gets into the heavier drugs, the major tranquilizers, antipsychotics, and mood stabilizers, I think, in general, almost exclusively, I think it's better not to use them at all. Mm-hmm. But then what it requires is it requires a therapist or friends or family members or doctors or whoever it is that's part of that person's social support system to really make themselves emotionally available and to really connect with people. And that takes a huge amount of energy for anybody who wants to connect with someone who's going through really extreme problems. And many times, by the time somebody comes to therapy or by the time they go to the hospital, a lot of the people in their social support system, even if it's therapists, professionals, have kind of burned out. And they just, like, they can't deal with it anymore. And they're like, just take something to chill out. Mm-hmm. Get you out of my life because it's too much. And I personally experienced it. So coming back to why I started making films, another reason was I was burning out. I was sitting with people 30, 40 hours a week hearing intense traumas. And because when I really asked, I heard a lot of stuff. I worked with a lot of war veterans in the United States. I worked with a lot of rape victims. I worked with a lot of people who'd been sexually and physically abused by their parents. These were normal things that I heard about every day. And what I realized is this took a toll on me. It made me exhausted. I actually got sick. My guts got really sick on the inside. And finally, I was like, when I discovered filmmaking and I discovered that I could instead make films about this and share them with people, it was so much easier. I was like, my God, I never thought filmmaking would be such an easier film. Yeah, it was stressful to make films. It took a lot of work. I had to learn a lot of new stuff. But once it started working, I was like, I don't think I can go back to being a therapist. I gave it 10 years. Now I need a break. Can't listen to people so much anymore. For instance, like you doing your job, sitting and listening. It takes energy. People don't realize, I think.
Vi doista mislite da vas slušam.
Well, you're either a fantastic therapist or you're a great actor. I can't figure it out yet.
Zaokružit ćemo točan odgovor. Jedno pitanje je zapravo, ispravite me ako grešim. Često puta kada se radi o ljudima, dakle mentalnim poremećajima koji mogu doista ugroziti ljudski život ili dovesti do toga da se čovjek ubije, postavka je sljedeća. U redu, ne možemo čovjeku pomoći trenutno, ali mu možemo dati neke lijekove da se ne ubije. Pa ćemo poslije mu možda moći pomoći ako je živ, a mrtvom sigurno nećemo moći. Međutim, iz svega što ste rekli po ovim napucima, zapravo takvog čovjeka teško izvući i on ostaje u stvari vezan uz lijekove negdje između pravog života i okolnosti koje ga sprečavaju da bi se ubio. To je ovako drastični primjer. Što kažete na primjenu lijekova u takvim drastičnim uvjetima? To nas naravno dovodi do pitanja uopće odgovornosti za čovjekov život. Na kraju krajeva i do pitanja da li treba nekom dopustiti da počini najdrastičnije mjere protiv sebe ili ne, ili će možda neke drastične mjere mu pomoći da prođe kroz nešto. To je sad vrlo teško moralno pitanje, ali kako vi gledate na tu stvar gdje lijekovi recimo su nešto što čovjeka sprječava da bi recimo ubio se ili si napravio fizičku štetu veliku?
So the drastic situations you're describing, when someone's problems are so severe that maybe that you say only medication will be useful or putting them in the hospital, something like that. Those are the drastic measures, those kind of psychiatric interventions. Well, the first thing I would say is to find out what that person wants. If the person wants to go to the hospital and takes medication and has been offered alternatives that are really serious, good alternatives, then I think a person has every right to go to the hospital and every right to take medication. And I know some people who want those, even when they're offered alternatives. I think the problem that I have is that when someone's situation is really serious, okay, maybe they're a so-called danger to themselves or to other people, to force them to take medication is, to me, not a good idea. Mm-hmm. I don't like that.
And takvi ljudi su obično prisiljeni da uzimaju lijekove.
Yes. It depends on where, but force is a very complicated thing because sometimes, yes, they're given the needle. They're strapped down. I've heard many stories about people in Croatia being strapped down and being forced, literally, needle or forced to take the drugs. But I think psychiatry has other ways to force people. Basically, they can have many people standing around and the doctor in the white coat, and they're saying, this is what you need to do. They're given no alternative. They're afraid that they won't be able to get their freedom and get out unless they take the pills. And they seem like they have a little bit of choice. Maybe they can say no, but in actual fact, they really don't feel like they can say no. So basically, they are forced. And I think the problem that I've seen is that force itself causes a lot of trauma. When people don't feel they have a real right to choose and they're not given alternatives and they're not able to make decisions about their own lives, often people are left feeling very powerless. They're left feeling very weak. And the problem is, what leads people to have many of these problems in the first place was that sense of powerless, that sense of weakness. That sense of powerless and weakness and vulnerability, in my experience, is a consequence of trauma. So when the actual psychiatric system does the exact same thing to people, leaving them feeling more powerless, feeling more weak, feeling like they have less choice, like they're being pressured again to do things that they maybe inside don't really want to do, that's a bad thing. So I think the job of psychiatry, no matter how serious someone's problems are to find other alternatives, to find other options, to give people choices, to help them get their own sense of agency back, to feel like they're people who can make decisions about their lives, people who are in control of their own destiny. And what you said is basically an argument that I've heard many, many times, that when people are so out of control that they could kill themselves or they could kill themselves, they could kill someone else, that we as society, we as doctors, we as mental health professionals need to decide what's best for them. What I found when I actually sit with people and listen to them is that's often not the case. It seems like it's the case, but it's often the case for people who actually haven't sat and really listen to people and given them a lot of time. I've seen people that are so suicidal that it's really scary. They've done things that are like all the different checklist things for what suicidal people done. They've cut their hair off. They've given away all their belongings. They say they're suicidal. They're thinking about suicide. They have a plan, but they don't want to go to the hospital. They can. And so just to finish for one second, what I've seen is they can come, and I've had it happen several times where they're sitting with me and they're having all these symptoms and they've seen other therapists and the therapist says, you need to go to the hospital. They don't want to go. And what I find, sitting and talking with them, developing a relationship with them, that in itself, and it can often happen very, very quickly, can give a person who is supposedly out of control a sense of hope again. And when people have that sense of hope, often their anxiety comes way down, their sense of usefulness can start to go up, and they can start thinking in different ways that would be considered rational. And it's a lot of work for the therapist to do, or a friend, or whoever's doing it. But that alone is enough to really help people not have to go to the hospital. And to me, that is a real alternative. So often those people who supposedly need that serious diagnosis, need those medications, need that hospitalization, need to be restrained, need to be locked up and be treated by someone else from the outside above them, those people really don't need it. And it's just that the people who say they need it never really, in a scientific way, explored what other alternatives are. And those alternatives can be really helpful, from what I've found.
Pretpostavljam da mnogi ljudi, profesionalci u tom poslu, osjećaju određenu odgovornost ako bi se dogodile neke stvari po njima loše, pa možda iz nekakvog sigurnosti ili straha rađe kreću sa oštrim mjerama, upravo zato da ne bi bili na kraju se osjećali odgovornim ako je netko nešto počinio, a eto, mogao si spriječiti to ili slično. Ali, nažalost, život je prepun rizika i svaka situacija za sebe, tako da koliko god se netko trudio, ne može izbjeći da ponekad, kako bi se reklo, ispadne na neki način kriv za neku situaciju, ako se to uopće može tako nazivati, s obzirom da na neki način su ipak ljudi najodgovorniji za svoje postupke u konačnici. Koliko god danas ta psihijatrija i sva ta veza između farmaceutske industrije i psihijatrije ide u hodanim tokovima, toliko se ipak u zadnjih 10 godina negdje na rubovima pojavljuju mnoge nove spoznaje i istraživanja vezana uz mnogo područja i vrlo često svi oni vode do onog što se danas popularno već naziva rana trauma. Znači, o stvari koje su često vezane čak i uz prve 3 godine života, uopće ne pričamo o teškim slučajevima, nego o stvarima koje muče ljude u svakodnevnom životu. Nesanice, tjeskobe, panični strahovi, stvari s kojima ljudi zapravo žive, ali možda nisu baš ugodne u životu. U vašim tekstovima sam također vidio da se vrlo često svi vektori dođu do te rane traume. Kako vi gledate na upravo to razdoblje i upravo na vezu rane traume sa svim ostalim razdobljima ljudskog života i zbog čega nastaje rana trauma? To je ključno pitanje, jer moderno društvo je praktički stroj za stvaranje rane traume.
Yeah. Oof. Well, first I would say childhood trauma is far more extreme than most people give it credit for. Perhaps more extreme and more ubiquitous. It's everywhere, more than even I realize. I think I often even learning how much more traumatized I was than I realize I am. And where does it all come from? I think people underestimate how many needs a child has, how broad their needs are. And I think, I mean, I know Croatian society less than American society, but what I see here too with people with babies is there's a lot of underestimation of what their needs are. And they, like, I think that babies' needs are so profound that when they don't get their needs met in really serious ways, they don't get the love, the attention, the dedication, the focus, even nutrition, caring, proper sleep, all these things, they can get traumatized. And I think part of it is we live in a world that really underestimates children's and babies' feelings. And so many things can happen that when children are feeling overwhelming feelings, when they're feeling out of control, people just consider that normal. Oh, that's what little kids go through. That's what one-year-olds go through. Oh, that's what two-year-olds go through. We have words in English like the terrible twos and the terrible threes. And to me, it's like these are expressions of traumatized children. These aren't expressions of children who are just going through a normal developmental phase. And what I found is the psychology field, by and large, doesn't see what childhood trauma really is. And when people grow older, those traumas are still in there. They're still unresolved, and they're still bubbling inside of people. And yeah, like you said, there are extreme things that can happen to children that people would pretty much agree. Anytime you see a little child get raped, that's considered a trauma, or a child getting really seriously damaged. But, I mean, I'm coming from a culture when I was a little boy that every boy was circumcised. Their penis was, the tip of it was cut off, and that was considered okay. And it's like, what is wrong with our society in America, where you're going to go to America and find this is happening still to tons of American boys? And a lot of it, I don't know now as much, but certainly back when I was a kid, it was done without anesthesia. And it's like, all these little boys, a whole generation of boys are traumatized this way. And that's just one little thing. And you wonder, how does that affect society? I don't know. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I wonder, like, all this violence in our world, this violence in our culture, where does it come from? What do children see with their parents fighting in front of them? When their parents also are traumatized, because this goes on for generation after generation. So for me, it's like, if I think, and also a huge part of it is people, when they're traumatized, they have overwhelmed feelings. Their feelings are really kind of out of control. So part of the experience of becoming traumatized is people put down their feelings, put a lid on it, put it down, and they split off from themselves. And sometimes it can happen in extreme ways where people really can almost have like different identities. But I think in normal ways, it's considered like that's what normal people do. You have to put your feelings aside. And a lot of it was like what my supervisors and other therapists told me when I was first becoming a therapist. You have to learn how to split off from your work. When your day is done, you have to let it go. I think really what it was is they were very traumatized people who were just putting their feelings aside. And for me, I was less traumatized than they were. I think I could see reality more clearly. And so that had more access to my inner self. And so when I see people in the world, I often just see adults who are walking around in adult bodies who, when I watch their behavior, I feel like I'm watching little traumatized children living in adult bodies. Mm-hmm. And when I see things like things that are diagnosed as schizophrenia and mm-hmm. things like psychosis, often when I look, I'm like, oh my God, this is a traumatized child acting out through the body of a 45-year-old man. And he's expressing himself exactly how a little child who's traumatized and is trying to express his feelings would do, except he's doing it 40 years too late. And society sees this as insane. It's crazy. But to me, it's like, no. He's actually behaving in a very appropriate way mm-hmm. for a really upset, angry, wounded 2 or 3-year-old. And that scares people. Because I think what happens is when you see someone who's crazy, who's labeled crazy, who's expressing mm-hmm. all these traumas, I think it taps into everybody's fear. And I think that's why people often want to stay away from that. I know I've gone off on a little tangent, but I'm getting excited.
Radi se o tome da je nemoguće iz formule ljudskog društva izbaciti ljude s obzirom da oni stvaraju društvo. I sasvim je logično ako se ljudsko društvo sastoji od velike količine na ovaj ili onaj način traumatiziranih ljudi ili odsječenih od svojih osjećaja, da će se to manifestirati i u društvu. U tvrtkama će vlada takva atmosfera, u državnoj upravi će vlada takva atmosfera, u školama i ona će se jednostavno prosljeđivati i postati norma ponašanja. Ovdje u Zagrebu postoji centar za prirodno roditeljstvo koji konkretno se upravo bavi ranom traumom, odnosno učenjem ljude kako da budu dobri roditelji, ali uvijek sa početnom tezom da otkriju gdje je to dijete u njima skriveno i traumatizirano, jer bez liječenja, bez shvaćanja te stvari, ne može se ukloniti taj negativni program koji se onda prosljeđuje generacijama. I naravno, često puta je već samo shvaćanje dovoljno da se to riješi, s obzirom da se ne radi o drastičnim stvarima. Sad, za samo shvaćanje možda je potrebno i 3, 6 mjeseci i godinu dana, ali nikako ne cijeli život. U kojoj mjeri je moguće da se ljudi sami sebi pomognu? Znači, ono što se zove samopomoć, evo znamo da imamo te mnogobrojne grupe podrške i vi ste sami ovdje došli na poziv jednu od tih grupa i ima ih još po Hrvatskoj. Kad dođe do pitanja samopomoći, to je opet veliko pitanje, može li se neki od onih ljudi koje ste spominjali sam sebi pomoći? Da može, možda bi već pomogao. A možda i može, ako postoji neki katalizator. Kako vi gledate na odnos liječenja i samopomoći? Mislim, očigledno je da ste vi više osmjereni prema ideji da bi čovjek mogao na neki način sam sebi pomoći. Ali kako u praksi, recimo kod onih svih drastičnih slučajeva koje ste imali?
Well, my primary example of self-help is my own life. I know how much I've helped myself, and I actually know how little mental health professionals actually helped me. I think I figured it out. I tried going to therapy, and I realized not only was it not helpful, it was actually kind of hurtful, and it was expensive, too. I'm like, I'm spending all this money for someone who's not helping me. And I, thankfully, was intuitive enough to figure it out, and I was like, I'd better find other things. But when I say self-help, I think it doesn't mean that I have to do it in complete isolation with just myself, because I think a huge part of good self-help is having the motivation and the ability to reach out and connect with other people who can be helpful. Friendship can be a wonderful part of self-help. I know for a lot of people, when they have really extreme problems, extreme conflicts, their behavior is considered really different or outside of the norm, it can be very hard to find friends. It can be very hard to make connections. And I have met people who have actually found some of their best friends inside of mental hospitals because they can find people in an environment where they're spending a lot of concentrated time with people who are also different. And sometimes people who are pretty different can be more accepting and more open-minded about other people who have different behavior. And that's a wonderful thing. But I think there's so many ways that people, even with really extreme problems, can practice self-help. A different way, I think self-help sounds almost like pop psychology or new age. And I think something that can really be more useful to people is just self-care. Mm-hmm. I like that. Simple things like practice some discipline in going to bed at a reasonable hour every night. Mm-hmm. Practice eating good food at regular times. Put a little discipline in not using so much drugs and not drinking so much alcohol. Mm-hmm. A lot of people find that really helpful. Get out of the house. Exercise a little bit. Mm-hmm. I've seen this so many times where people just start exercising mildly, taking a walk for a few kilometers mm-hmm. a day, maybe 3-4 times a week. Mm-hmm. That, for some people, is enough to just change their mindset, mm-hmm. give them a sense of empowerment. But I think one of the main things that I see with help that's different from what the mental health field does is the mental health field, psychiatry, often has an attitude, we are going to do this treatment to you, and this will help you. And so it's the idea of something coming from up high down to you, and then this will help you. The idea with self-help or self-care is that it has to come from within the person, him or herself. And it places the responsibility back on a person. And I think when many people, especially if they've been traumatized, they have lost that sense of empowerment. And psychiatry, again, often takes it away too. So it reinforces the idea that they are not really in control of their own destiny. And the idea of self-help or self-care is that people, again, they have to look within themselves. They have to start self-reflecting. And I think even for people with really extreme problems, I've seen people diagnosed with schizophrenia for 20 years start doing things like journaling. Sometimes they can do it. Some people who don't even have this diagnosis, who have no diagnosis at all, have a very hard time journaling and writing down their feelings, writing down their thoughts, writing down their dreams. It makes them uncomfortable because they don't want to be too connected with their feelings because their feelings can be very threatening sometimes. But I've seen people with really extreme problems who can start journaling and can find a friend in a journal. I've met many people who their journal is their first real friend. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's their first real friend for mm-hmm. a long time. Mm-hmm. That's a good one. Mm-hmm. People can start analyzing their dreams. Look at their dreams. What does this mean? It's like this message is coming from somewhere. And I don't mean like following Carl Jung mm-hmm. or just follow your own heart. Guess what this dream is trying to say. Mm-hmm.
Za ovih zadnjih nekoliko minuta emisije možda bi bilo dobro osvrnuti se na dva teksta koje imate na internetu zbog toga jer oni predstavljaju jednu zbirku praktičnih savjeta ili nekih točaka. Jedan od njih je savjeti za roditelje na tragu onog što ste već prije govorili o ranoj traumi i kako se trauma prosljeđuje. Kada biste trebali nabrojati recimo tih nekoliko točaka bez puno objašnjavanja u detalje, a da se znači ne stvaraju dodatno traumatizirani pojedinci u društvu, koji bi bili ti savjeti iz perspektive svega što ste do sada rekli? Ja bih vam mogao pomoći jer imam ovdje sprintano, ali neću.
Well, how about we do it as a quiz? Because I haven't read that in a while. So you tell me how good I do.
U redu.
I probably wrote that 5 or 10 years ago. I don't remember. But let's see. What could parents do to traumatize their children the least? I would say the first thing a parent could do to traumatize their child the least is the parent to start to work on their own self, to really find satisfaction in their own life. Listen to their children. The parent could practice really good self-care, practice good self-therapy, really work out the mom or the dad could work out their relationship with each other, so develop a really strong partnership with each other, develop a circle of friends. I think a lot of parents end up in a lot of social isolation.
Da vidimo dalje. Recimo, nemojte se oslanjati
na vaše... I don't remember what I wrote. What did I say?
Evo, napisali ste, nemojte se oslanjati na vaše dijete, jer vaše posao da budete ovdje za dijete, a ne da ono vas vodi, pomaže vam, inspirira vas, daje vam utjehu, voli vas i slično. Potom ste napisali, bilo je puno točaka, 12, neke od njih sam izdvojio, nemojte koristiti nikakvu vrst kažnjavanja. Potom, vjerujte negativnim osjećajima vašeg djeteta.
I like that.
Meni se posebno sviđala kada vaše dijete želi slobodu, dajte mu je, jer ono nije kućni ljubimac, nego neka vrsta divlje životinje. Može biti leptir, može biti tigar, ali nije kućni ljubimac. Drago mi da vam se sviđaju vaši vlastiti tekstovi. Evo za kraj još i ne provjere. Napravili ste tekst 10 načina kako biste vi ustrojili sustav mentalnog zdravlja, da budemo konkretni. Tih 10 načina je u stvari nekih 10 točaka. Većinu smo ih obrazlagali. Na koji način biste vi postavili, recimo, da imate priliku, mogućnost ili da vam neko da takve ovlasti ili da možete poručavati ljude i možda se to i dogovori? Kako biste postavili, znači, taj sustav mentalnog zdravlja, evo, u tih 10 točaka ili koliko vam god padne na pamet?
Oh. Well, first of all, stop forcing people to do anything. Give people a lot of choice. That's the most important thing I hear over and over and over again. Give people alternatives. So let it's like going to a restaurant where you can choose many different things. Let psychiatry become like that, where people can choose what they want. Not what they want to eat so much, I mean, that's nice, but what kind of help they want, or if they don't want any help. I think also stop taking money from the pharmaceutical industry. I think the pharmaceutical industry has really bought psychiatry. I remember the first time I came to Croatia, I was at a conference in Dubrovnik, and the only information there for the international conference that was available in Croatian was all drug company literature. And I'm like, what is this? Oh my God, it feels like I'm back in America.
Ponovili ste ovdje jednu tvrdnju, nacionalizirati farmaceutske tvrtke da ne bi više imali status profitne tvrtke. To je recimo jedna od točaka.
Yeah.
Ali idemo dalje, da vidimo.
I've never gotten a chance to say that in a former communist country. I don't know how it sounds. When I wrote it, I think it was like
Ovdje onako sve bilo nekada davno državno, prema tome ideja nacionalizacije nije toliko strana kao u Americi. Spominjali ste da treba promijeniti hijerarhiju u sustavu. Tko je gornji, tko je donji? Što ste time mislili?
Yes, I think the people who should have the most power in the mental health system, for starters, should be the people known as patients. Let them decide. And to remember that everyone else is actually working for them, not telling them what to do, so not locking them up. I think unlock the mental hospitals. Let people leave if they want.
Pa ja ponekad kada gledam televiziju, čini mi se da su i vrata ludnice stalno otvorena.
Oh, you're watching politics?
Yes. Dobro, i da završimo naravno sa ovom točkom na neki način odbacivanja, to je prva točka bila u vaših 10 načina kako povratiti mentalni sustav u ruke nekih dobrih ciljeva, napustiti noze iz ovih priručnika, poput DSM-a.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, get rid of them. I think that you know, like people become drug addicts and they become addicted to drugs. I think mental health professionals have become addicted to diagnosis because that gives them power and it gives them something to hold on to. I say, if you get rid of diagnosis, the mental health professionals, they can't start looking at a person as a diagnosis. Instead, they have to look at a person as a human being. A human being with a history, with feelings, with dreams, with desires. And I think if mental health professionals get rid of all those diagnoses, they're not going to have something to grab onto to place on top of a person. And what I've heard from so many people over the years is having diagnoses doesn't help them change, doesn't help them work through their problems. So I'm all for getting rid of the diagnoses and starting over again with something completely different. Let's go back to something that actually is more scientifically valid and useful, not these random arbitrary diagnoses that are actually pretty insulting.
Također ste se bavili i pitanjem toga koliko se rijetko postavlja pitanje uopće ovisnosti o tim lijekovima i kako se riješiti tih ovisnosti, ali nažalost eto, najlakše ih se riješiti tako da ih se ne uzima, kao što ste i rekli. U svakom slučaju, Daniele, želim vam sretan put dalje po gdje vas već vodi. Još filmova, osim ovih nekoliko koliko ste napravili, i do neke sljedeće prilike, pa kad opet dođete u Hrvatsku, možemo se opet družiti.
Yeah, and maybe who knows, I'll have a television show in America and you can come and be my guest. You're welcome.
Dogovoreno. Vidimo se, hvala, a hvala i vama na pažnji. Evo, nije od jučer shvaćanje da ljudi imaju moć izlečenja u sebi samima, pogotovo o tome treba razmisliti iz perspektive korištenja svakakvih medikamenata za različita mentalna stanja koja su, eto, dobile svoje kratice, makar mnogo od njih možda predstavljaju tek jedan raspon ljudskih osjećaja i raspoloženja i naravno s tih lijekova vrlo teško skinuti. S druge strane, u svakome postoji potencijal da utječe na vlastito zdravlje, kako fizičko, tako i psihičko, pa čak da izliječi svoje veze i druge okolnosti koje čine ono što zovemo život, i na tom putu svaka pomoć je dobro došla kao katalizator, ali na kraju svatko ipak snosi odgovornost za vlastiti život jer nema nikog drugog da to učini. Pa čak i kad se uzme u obzir da je proizvodnja trauma svojevrsna norma modernog društva. Laku noć!